One of the problems that many of our youth have, and alhamdulillah, I like the series of problems that are mentioned in this particular seminar or segment because they're very relevant. Of course, the problem of time, the problem of excuses, the problem I'm never going to be this and that. But one of the problems is that our youth really do not have high expectations and high goals. They settle for mediocrity. They're fine with just being okay or average or just passing the grade. And they don't set their standards very high. And I find this to be extremely problematic because the Quran and Sunnah is very clear that we set our goals to the heights and we don't settle for mediocrity. We're not satisfied with just being average or okay. We aim for the best and we strive for excellence in all that we do. And you know, I could quote you so many stories about the classical scholars, about Ibn Taymiyyah, about An-Nawawi, about so and so. But wallahi, the fact of the matter is that there are living examples in the very world around us. People that most of us know and have heard about who set their standards very high and they were persistent and dedicated and they reached the heights of whatever they were doing, even though when they started, people would have laughed and scoffed at them. Who are you to go and become such and such? And I give you the example of perhaps one of the most legendary scholars of the Quran alive today, or I should say scholars of the recitation of the Quran, one of the Qurra, one of the most famous Qurra, whom we were blessed to have to one of our conferences, Sheikh Ahmed Nu'ayna. Sheikh Ahmed Nu'ayna, just log on to YouTube and just see the amounts of videos that, and the amounts of viewers that have seen his videos, in the millions. And he is no doubt one of the most legendary scholars of the recitation of the Quran. He's mastered all 10 qira'at. Allah has blessed him with one of the top voices in the world. Do you know that he grew up in an upper class Egyptian background, having very little to do with Islamic sciences? He didn't go to an Islamic school. In fact, by training, he was a doctor. Again, going back to our previous speaker's point that doctors, mashallah, they have done quite a lot. One of the reasons, in my opinion, is because they learn time management. They learn that they need to utilize their time to the max. Dr. Ahmed Nu'ayna was a pediatrician. He specialized. He didn't even just do a general doctorate. He became a pediatrician. And he was, and he still is a pediatrician, a practicing pediatrician. One day he decided, you know what? I want to memorize the Quran. As a middle-aged man, he decides to memorize the Quran. He gets this idea that, you know what? I want to master the Quran. And he goes to one of the greatest scholars who happened to live in his neighborhood of the Quran. And this scholar said to him, you want to memorize the Quran? He said, yes. He said, I want from you just one thing, dedication. He said, of course, I'm dedicated. But he said, Sheikh, I'm a doctor. I don't have all the time in the world, but I can be dedicated and persistent. So the Sheikh said to Dr. Ahmed Nu'ayna, fine, you need to memorize and master two lines of the Quran every day. The Sheikh said, look, I know I don't have time, but two lines, come on. I can do more than two lines. Two lines is nothing. A kid can do two lines. The Sheikh said, no. Your requirement is two lines, but you master all of the rules, all of the differences in these two lines a day. So the Sheikh told us, Dr. Ahmed Nu'ayna, he told us, you know, I began. And slowly but surely, you know, there's only a few thousand lines of the Quran, really. You know, there's only 600 pages in the Quran. If you memorize two lines a day, you're basically finishing a page in 7 days. So a week you finish a page, right? And there's only 600 pages. He's already memorized 4 or 5 juz. So he has around 20, 25 juz left. So basically in a few years, he finishes the whole Quran. And because he's studying with the Sheikh, he memorizes all of the different recitations, all of the qira'at. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with a beautiful voice. Guess what happened? Slowly but surely, he began being invited to different events to recite, graduations, other events, until slowly but surely, he began to rise up in the ranks of Qurra, even though he's not a Qari by training initially. He's a pediatrician. And he kept on rising and rising until lo and behold, right now he's one of the top living legends of the recitation of the Qur'an, and he is still a pediatrician by day. Because he didn't put any barriers on his limits. He said, you know what? Bismillah, let's go for it. And he's a living example, and there are so many other examples. One of the scholars that I was greatly fortunate to study with in Medina, Many of you do not know his name because he doesn't have any books in English. His name is Sheikh Atiyah Salim. Sheikh Atiyah Salim was one of the greatest scholars in the Haram of the Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he had one of the largest halaqas in the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What a great honor. What a great honor that is to be able to teach in the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he would teach in the middle area. You know, these days most of the teachers are in the corners and peripheries. He would teach right in the middle. And it is one of the most blessed locations really to teach. Now Sheikh Atiyah, when I began studying with him, I thought this guy must be, you know, PhD from Azhar, this and that. He's one of the top scholars of the world. I had no idea. I was a young kid going in Medina, studying Islam, and everybody recommended his halaqah. I began studying with him. And I was shocked to discover his life story. His life story was that he came to Medina back in the late 50s, not as a scholar, not as a student of knowledge, but as a radio technician. Radio technician. The Masjid of the Prophet had just installed microphones, had just installed an entire stereo system. This is in the 50s, right? Brand new, cutting edge technology to have a microphone back then. And because, you know, Saudi Arabia was not a country that had technology, there were no Saudis that were qualified to take charge of operating it, managing it. So they imported this person. His name is Atiyah Salim. He's a technician from Egypt. And he's trained to be a technician. And so he comes and he's assigned the responsibility of monitoring the microphones of the Haram, and in particular the microphone of the greatest scholar of his time, and his name is Sheikh Shanqiti. So this person who was to become the Sheikh Atiyah Salim, what was his job? To set up the microphone, make sure it's working, wait till the session finishes, then shut the system down. So day in, day out, night, every evening, every day, he would sit in the halaqah of the Sheikh. And he became interested in knowledge himself because he's sitting right there. But his job was that of a technician. And sitting with the Sheikh year after year inspired him so much that he started studying on his own. And eventually, he quit his job to become a full-time student with the Sheikh. And eventually, when the Sheikh passed away, the most qualified student they found to sit in the chair that the Sheikh used to occupy was Sheikh Atiyah Salim, who used to be the technician of the Sheikh. And when I came to Medina, he was now in his late 60s, early 70s, right? And subhanAllah, his story was what? That he came as a technician. He's in his 20s. He hasn't gone to Islamic school from his childhood. But he has a desire and dedication, and he doesn't put a limit. He doesn't put a barrier. I'm going to go wherever I can go, as far as I can go. So a radio technician eventually becomes one of the greatest scholars who teaches in the Haram of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because he didn't put his sights down. He didn't say, oh, it's too late. He didn't say, what am I going to do? I'm just a technician. I'm not even a Saudi. You know, there's an issue. You have to be Saudi. He became Saudi. Because he was so great of a scholar, the government gave him citizenship. Khalas, we want you to be here. And slowly but surely he rose in ranks until he is one of the greatest living, the greatest scholars of fiqh of his time. Rahimahullah ta'ala, he passed away in late 1995, early 1996. And Allah blessed me just to study with him for less than a year. And you know, the issue of aiming for the highest is something that is clearly encouraged in the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. Be patient, just like the greatest prophets were, the ulul azm of the prophets were patient. Who are the ulul azm? Who knows? Who are the ulul azm? The five ulul azm, yes. Number one, chronologically, Nuh. Number two, Ibrahim. Number three, Musa, Isa, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are the five greatest prophets. And they are called Ulul Azm. What does Allah tell us in the Quran? فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. He's telling me and you to be patient like the patience of those prophets. Now hold on a sec. Are we ever going to have that type of patience? I'm asking you. Are we? No. Yet Allah says, take that as your standard. Aim for the highest. Go up all the way there. فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. That's where your standard is. The Prophet ﷺ said to us, hadith is in Sahih Muslim, the hadith goes that a man came to the Prophet ﷺ, Rabi'at ibn Ka'b, the famous Sahabi, Rabi'at ibn Ka'b. He had volunteered to become a servant for the Prophet ﷺ. Rabi'at ibn Ka'b volunteers his services. And he says, and he helps the Prophet ﷺ, gives him water for wudu, does any chores that he wants. He volunteers to be a servant for the Prophet ﷺ. And one day the Prophet ﷺ was so impressed at him. And Rabi'a, by the way, is not one of the big names of the Sahaba. Most of you have never heard of his name because he's not Abu Huraira, he's not Ubay ibn Ka'b, he's not Ibn Mas'ud, he's not Abu Bakr. Rabi'a ibn Ka'b, we really don't know much about him at all. He's one of the quote-unquote average of the Sahaba. The Prophet ﷺ one day says to him, "Oh Rabi'a, what can I give you in return? You've done so much for me." Meaning, you know, 1,000 dinar, something like this. I'll give you a gift. "Oh Rabi'a, what can I give you in return? Ask me something that I can do for you." Rabi'a instantaneously asks the one thing that's been on his mind. And look at where he's aiming. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, I want to be with you in Jannah." Look at where he's aiming. Look at where he's aiming. "I want to be with you in Jannah." Now, is every single human being going to be with the Prophet ﷺ in Jannah? That's the highest level of Jannah, right? But he is aiming for the gold. He's aiming for the highest. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, uridu murafaqataka fil Jannah. I want to be your companion. I want to be with you at your level in Jannah." Subhanallah, this is what you call aiming high. And the Prophet ﷺ said, if that is the case, first he asked him, "Don't you want anything else? Awa ghayra thalik? I mean, I was expecting some money. I was expecting a horse, a camel. Don't you want anything else?" He said, "Huwa thak. That's all I want, Ya Rasulullah. That's my goal. That's all I want." And so the Prophet ﷺ said, if that is the case, fa'a'inni ala nafsika bikathratis sujood. Help me get you this goal. Because I can't, I don't control the keys to Jannah. I can only make dua, it's up to Allah. I don't control where you go. I don't snap my fingers and say, kun fayakun. I can make dua. But if you really want it, then help me help you. Help me help you to get to that goal by having lots of sajdas. Pray a lot and perhaps you'll get there. The point here is, where did this Sahabi aim for the heights? I want to be with you in Jannah. He didn't say, "Who am I? I haven't memorized the Quran. I'm not an Abu Huraira. I'm not a Khalid ibn al-Walid." No. He put the goal the highest, and inshallah ta'ala, he'll get it.